Well, Bryan Bartels is in what we used to call big trouble. Hi, I'm Scott Ott, and this episode of Right Angle with Bill Whittle and Stephen Green is brought to you by the members at BillWhittle.com. Bryan Bartels is a 20-year-old man boy who was participating alongside of protesters who were calling for racial justice and an end to police violence against primarily African-American victims. And he insinuated himself into the crowd while wearing a black hoodie and black jeans and a black mask, and decided that he would tag a police SUV and then break its windows. And there's some indication in the story I read at theblaze.com that the vehicle was actually set on fire. He got ratted out by some colleagues at work who said he was the guy behind the mask. And the beautiful conclusion to this story is that Bryan Bartels was marched down to the Pittsburgh police station by mommy and daddy. Stephen Green, one of the most encouraging things about this video, in addition to the genuine shame that should come upon this young man, was the encouraging response of the crowds of protesters when he started bashing the police car. And that was basically, stop it, you moron. That's not what this is about. Steve, is there any way to police the people who, like this Bryan Bartels, who decide to use this opportunity as a chance for them to live out their chaotic anarchist fantasies?
You know, we talked about this. Bill talked about this on the lightning round, which I won't give any spoilers. That's usually the last one we'll release throughout the week of these four. But in Giuliani's New York, when there were riots, somebody got violent. Boom, they arrested that guy. Somebody else did. Boom, they arrested that guy too. And as a result, they had peaceful protests that rarely turned into riots. It was a pretty well-run city. Bill de Blasio, he thinks these riots are a great thing. His daughter was arrested in one of them. It's awful. It's just it's terrible, the changes that have come to New York City over these last few years. That said, what I hate seeing is a genuine movement getting effectively kidnapped by people who have absolutely nothing to do with it. We're talking about this started as a protest against police brutality that resulted in the untimely death, the killing, the murder of an American citizen. When you see, let me back this up a minute. Let me explain to you just how terrible I think what happened in Minneapolis was. You can find on some of the darker spots on the internet Saudi execution videos, and it's kind of shocking about what a informal affair a Saudi execution can be if you're not in one of the major cities. Just some guys drag out another guy into a public street. The one guy, you know, has got his wrists bound, and a crowd gathers around at a respectful distance, and some words are said, and another guy pulls out a sword and hacks the guy's head off. But in our understanding, Saudi Arabia is a pretty lawless country. They have laws, they have Sharia, but in terms of how they go about executing these laws, no pun intended, to our eyes, and not just our eyes, it's essentially lawless. What happened to George Floyd with that police officer just crushing the back of the man's neck with his knee and just leaving it there while carrying on a conversation and his partner's going about his duties. And it's just so casual and awful and in a way unintentional that somehow makes it worse. You can't wrap your brain around that. What you can do is get out in the streets and protest and try and get this kind of a thing to come to a stop. But then to have your righteous protest, to have your righteous anger co-opted by a bunch of Soros-funded thugs who want to use this as an excuse not to make this country better, but to tear it down. Now you have to get mad all over again.
Bill Whittle, the Pittsburgh police chief, a guy whose last name is Scott, said it was a damn shame that these Antifa-like rioters were taking advantage of the protest. And when I saw the little video snippet on Twitter, I don't know how to describe this, Bill, and you probably would be more aware of this than I am because I'm not a video gamer. But when I looked at this kid, I felt like he thought that he was in a video game. It reminded me of watching a six-year-old dressed in a Spider-Man suit who's, you know, running around thinking he's slinging webs. Like he was living out some sort of a fantasy. Do you understand what I'm getting at?
Yeah, he's playing Grand Theft Auto 5 is what he thinks he's doing. And he thinks that's basically it. This is what you do, and you go out, and now is a chance to do it in the real world. And now he's going to realize what all the rest of these people in Antifa realize. So listen carefully, Antifa. If you go down, march you down the streets of this country, smashing windows and burning cars, you will be arrested, and then you will be given a very serious time out. You will have your internet privileges curtailed. You won't be able to go to the prom, won't be able to borrow the car for at least 2 weeks. Mom is going to continue to buy your clothes, even though she said you might be able to buy your own if you behaved yourselves and so on. Those promises are off the table. The trip to Disney World is probably going to be gone. And you're going to have to eat more vegetables, honestly. And it's just not worth it, Antifa. It's not. Just don't do it. Because mom and dad are going to be really, really pissed if they found out that you burned down a police car. And this is what they deserve, this kind of mockery, because this is what they are. They're it's like a Halloween costume for them. They're kids. I'm generalizing, but I think it's generally pretty fair. They're well-to-do white kids who have no adventure in their lives. They have no guidance in their lives. Their parents have always given them anything. And if they have a temper tantrum in a Walmart at age six, the parents buy them a toy to get them to shut up. And this is the lesson that they've learned. And this lesson has been reinforced throughout their entire school career. Anytime they make noise or decide to do anything to challenge the authority of a school, a high school, a college, the authorities back down and immediately give them everything they want. So what else would they think? Steve was talking about what we talked about a bit on the Lightning Round show, and Giuliani talking about arresting people right away. And he had the same reaction that I did to watching police officers in Los Angeles. And I mean a bunch of them, 15 of them in riot gear, approach a store that was in the process of being looted. 15 police officers. And the rioters, the looters realize that the police are out there, and they come running out, and they go running right through the police, and they don't stop any of them. They don't arrest them at all. Nothing. This has got to be the mayor saying, no, we don't want to inflame passions. And what you're doing, mayor, is you're saying that if you are stealing, you smash a window, go in and take as much merchandise as you can, and you run out, and you have the misfortune to run into the few police officers who are on the scene because you're just not enough police for a situation like this, then you can run right through them with no consequences. So what is on earth to stop you? Why would you not do this? Why would you be astonished and amazed that punk kids from white neighborhoods who have to have mom and dad walk them down to the police station, why would you be amazed that they're using hammers to smash windows and paint cars? When has anyone ever enforced the rules on these children? Ever? In their lives? And the answer is never. There's never, ever been consequences for their actions in the course of their entire lives, which is why they think they can get away with it, and which, by the way, is why Antifa noticeably evaporates when confronted with veterans, motorcycle gangs, patriot groups, people with weapons, anything. All of a sudden, the tough guy mask comes off, and they realize, man, I'm in some real trouble. And I remember during one of these previous protests, where some of these Antifa punks were basically saying, I'm looking at 15 years in federal penitentiary. You know, what the hell's going on? Like, mystified that smashing a building and setting it on fire would have consequences. So there you go.
I found a number of things really refreshing about this story and the related video clips. Number one was the fact that here's a guy who is, you know, stepped forward in what he, I'm sure, felt was going to be a leadership role in kicking off a nice riot in the midst of a peaceful protest. And as a matter of fact, not only were people from the crowd shouting at him, telling him to stop doing what he was doing, including the guy who was videoing it, by the way, and was saying to him, I got you on video, you should not do this. But nobody joined in. Like nobody, you know, jumped in and said, you know, like, yeah, F the pigs and let's set their car on fire. So that was kind of refreshing. My favorite moment of it, though, had to be, you know, seeing them coming around the corner of that police station, dad in the lead, the little boy in the middle, and then mom behind him. And they've kind of got him hemmed in. They didn't have him cuffed or anything, but they were clearly, you know, frog marching him down to the police station. They didn't comment. The media's asking questions. Nobody made any comments. And, you know, the father appropriately steps behind his wife and holds the door to make sure he's kind of like this protective barrier. And that was all very encouraging to see parents acting like parents, even though this adult should have already, you know, not had the need for that kind of thing. My grandfather, Jim McMaster, used to tell me a story about when he was a teenager and he had a Model A Ford that he had bought used and had fixed up. And he was tearing down the road one day and got pulled over by what he would call the local gendarme, the local police officer. Yep. And he said that the cop walked up to the side of the car and looked at him and said, "Oh, it's you, Mac. I'm not going to write you a ticket. I'm just going to call your dad." And he said worse. at that point, the only thing that he wanted in the world was a ticket. Like, it was like, please write me a ticket. So, you know, it was great to see at least some measure of parental leadership and discipline and responsibility, even if it was a little late in coming for this kid. I don't know enough to, you know, I'm not blaming the parents for the kid's behavior. There's one other video that I saw, by the way, of a similarly cloaked white kid with a hammer who was chipping apart the curb of a sidewalk so that he could have objects to throw. And members of the crowd actually stepped in, grabbed the hammer from him, took the rocks, you know, the little concrete rocks away from him, and took him over to the police and said, "Here, take him."
Awesome.
So it's great stuff. And there's a lot more of that happening than the mainstream media is letting you see. And there are a lot of decent people out there who have legitimate, righteous indignation about things that they see that are wrong in our criminal justice system and in the particular behavior of the officer in the George Floyd situation and other situations like that. I would just encourage you to realize as you watch the nonstop stream of video that you're seeing what the mainstream media thinks you want to see and what they want you to see. You're not seeing everything. And there are a lot of responsible people out there who are doing the right thing and then stepping up when the wrong thing has been done. For Bill Whittle and Stephen Green, I'm Scott Odd. Thanks to the members at BillWhittle.com for making this possible.